Okay, I'm very excited to have on the Goldstein on Geld show, Professor of Economics at Harvard University, Oliver Hart. He's been there since 1993, and in 2016, he won the Nobel Prize in Economics for his work in contract theory. Now, Professor, I deal in contracts a lot in my day job as a financial advisor, things like new account documents that clients sign and options contracts, but somehow I have a feeling that the type of contracts that you have studied is not exactly that, or am I mistaken?
Well, Doug, I would say the following. The kind of contracts you're talking about are in the category of the things I study, but there are contracts which I find more interesting than that. Let me first say that contracts are everywhere in the world, and particularly in economic life. Even the simplest transaction where you go into a store and buy something, there's a contract behind that because you've agreed to buy the good, they've agreed to sell it, and you've agreed to pay whatever price they posted. But things get more interesting when time is involved. For example, if I borrow money from you, you hand over the money now, but you obviously are expecting me to repay later. And without some sort of contract that can be enforced, you might be worried that I'll disappear or I'll just refuse to pay. So I'm interested in debt contracts, insurance contracts, and also contracts between firms. And they're a bit more complicated than the option contracts you're talking about.
Well, what you just described before was a bond contract. When a client buys a bond, a corporate bond, frankly, I don't think they ever read the contract or see the contract, but there is a document that describes what the obligations are of both sides, no?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, if the firm gets into trouble and doesn't repay, then exactly what happens is very important. And that's written into the contract, or also, you know, it could be part of bankruptcy law. Mm-hmm. But the fact that there's some sort of enforcement ability there, that the firm cannot simply say, oh, I promised you a certain amount of money and now, sorry, I've changed my mind. They can't do that. You have some recourse in that situation. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in the optimal contract. So what's the best kind of contract to write in a situation like that?
Well, isn't it always a question of who's writing the contract? You always want to be the one who writes the contract when you're getting involved in a deal. So presumably, if a client's buying a bond, the company issued the contract, then the company has a benefit in that negotiation, no?
It's very interesting you say that, because economists don't look at it that way. And that's actually one of the important things about economics. Economists tend to think about contracts as maximizing the total size of the pie. So it's not really the company trying to take advantage of the customer. Why do we think of it that way? Well, you know, if the company writes a contract which is very disadvantageous to the customer, then presumably, unless the customer is completely clueless, the interest rate that they will require will be higher in that kind of situation. The company can't just dictate the terms and keep the price constant. The worse the terms are for the person holding the bond, as I say, you're going to have to compensate them in some way, let's say with a higher interest rate. So actually, it's in your interest as the person writing the contract to write a good one so that you're not hurt by the other side. Yeah, I mean, just to give you another example,
sure.
if I'm a firm and I'm, you know, I sell you a product with a very poor warranty. Do you call it a warranty in Israel? Guarantee?
Correct.
Basically, if anything goes wrong, it's going to be your problem, not mine. If people on the customer side are at all rational, they're not going to pay as much for a product like that. So actually, as the firm selling the product, it may well be in my interest to provide a very good warranty, because I can then charge a higher price.
That sounds more like a marketing issue like you're describing. In other words, the company figures with or without a warranty, they can either charge more or less. So it's a business decision. It's not necessarily trying to provide the maximizing the total size of the pie, as you said.
Oh, well, that's a very good point. But in fact, it turns out that the two things become equivalent. I mean, you know, it's a bit like Adam Smith. I mean, when he talked about businesses making money, you know, he pointed out that if there was competition, they would end up doing good for society, even though that wasn't their intention at all. And the same is true here. You're going to end up writing a contract. I mean, you can sort of establish this formally, that the contract that is best for the firm, assuming that the customer on the other side understands what's going on, is also going to be the contract that maximizes the total surplus.
Mm-hmm. We're talking with Professor Oliver Hart from Harvard University. He's the 2016 Nobel Prize laureate in economics. He specializes in contract theory. You know, Professor, one of the things that you talk about, and of course you go so in depth, is contracts. But it seems to me that in the financial world, like you mentioned, where they're so important, there is always an assumed contract. And, you know, it's funny, we're talking about this idea of bonds and bond contract. And in the 25 years I've been doing this, I don't think I've ever had a client who said to me, well, could I see the actual debt instrument that I'm buying? It seems to me that people have a huge amount of trust. I'm wondering where that comes from. And is it justified, or should people really be trying to get everything down on paper?
Well, I think one of the problems is it is true that a lot of the contracts people sign, they're very complicated and they don't read them very carefully. I mean, I think it's even true. I don't know so much about bond contracts, but if you just think about the products we buy in the marketplace, particularly high tech sorts of things, I mean, there can be very complicated terms to the contract. And sometimes these days, you know, when you buy something online, you have to check a box saying, I accept all the terms. you do that even when you go to a hotel and you get wireless internet, right?
Do you check the box when you go to the hotel?
Of course, because if I didn't, I would be spending the whole hotel stay reading the contract. And that's not quite the point of it, so of my vacation or whatever it is. So I do, and I assume that I'm not actually entering into something terrible. The contract didn't say that I owe them $1 million. I sort of assume that because everybody else is doing this, because this is a standard form thing, it's not personal to me, that if there was a problem, you know, there'd be some sort of class action suit, or some regulator would step in, or the courts would step in.
Is that a legitimate position for someone to have? Normal people, like you said, want to go on vacation and don't want to spend all day reading the contract. In the same way, you go to a bank or a brokerage firm to open an account, you're going to assume that the contract is reasonable. Is that fair for someone to assume, and therefore he can't later sue and say, you know, I didn't know there was a pre-arbitration clause in your contract?
Well, that's right. I think this kind of small transactions that I'm talking about, accepting Wi-Fi and that kind of thing, it's fine. But if you were doing something more serious, then I think you would be well advised to read the contract. For example, you know, with a job, if you're taking a job, and it turns out these days, I read about this in the newspapers, that sometimes as part of the terms of the employment contract, it says that there's a problem, it's going to be binding arbitration. Well, you might want to know that, mm-hmm. or you might not want to know whether you're agreeing to a covenant not to compete. I mean, that would be extremely important, you know, if you later found out, oh, I want to leave and get another job, and then the employer points out that you can't do that. Well, that's something you should have known from the get-go. It all depends on the size and importance of the transaction.
I see. So it's not a legitimate position in a larger contract, like you're saying, a work contract, to later come back and say, well, I didn't really understand what the non-compete meant. I didn't understand it meant that I couldn't actually go into the same business as you. That would not hold up?
I don't think the courts would be very sympathetic to that, mm-hmm. certainly in the United States. I mean, this is not what my work has been about up to now, but I think it's a very important issue. To what extent should people be required to flag things like that in their contracts? So you can have a contract with hundreds of pages, and it could be buried in small print. You're signing your life away. That wouldn't be good. I think that there's a very strong argument for regulators to intervene, or the courts to say, we won't enforce a contract like that. You should have made it completely clear to Doug that he was signing his life away. You know, it should have been in large letters. I think that's a reasonable approach. We should perhaps be moving more in that direction. But assuming I pointed it out to you that there's this covenant, I don't think it would be reasonable for you later on to say, oh, yes, I saw it, but I had no idea what it meant. That is not a good defense.
Mm-hmm. I see. Yeah, it's interesting what you're saying about putting it in bold. And I'm thinking now about the contract I mentioned before, the new account form that a client signs when he opens an account. There are sections, in fact, that are written in bold or important parts. We ask the client to initial specific sections, you know, to demonstrate that he actually read page 6 of the contract. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes. I mean, things like that, it should be, I think, part of the communication. If you're sitting there in front of the person, there should be some discussion that takes place.
Mm-hmm. I think the problem is the lawyers get so excited about writing these documents that, you know, I feel as an advisor, I explain to the client the risks and the costs and what's going on. And then the compliance officers who write these documents, this is all they do. So they're the ones who come up with the hundreds of pages that you're referring to, you know, let's say in a mutual fund prospectus. Do they do this because they think it binds the clients?
Well, I mean, I'm puzzled as much as anybody as to why these things have to be so complicated and why some of the language is so complicated, because I don't rent apartments anymore, but one of my sons has done so, and I looked at the lease he was signing, and I couldn't understand parts of it. The language was extremely old-fashioned. I don't think that's a good situation. I think we should be trying to move towards a situation where certainly the main elements can be explained using simple language.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I have to ask the political question, which is, do you think that should be enforced through legislation, or the courts should just be more reasonable about how they enforce contracts?
I think the court be in favor of both. Mm-hmm. I think there's a strong argument for really saying to the person who drafted the contract that if they don't make some effort to explain what it all means to the other person, then maybe certain more obnoxious parts shouldn't be enforced. And by the way, I also think, you know, another thing that we see these days worries me is that the amount of stuff that is confidential. You know, you have these settlements. When they settle things, they often have to agree not to say anything about what's happened. And I think, although I'm someone who basically respects freedom of contract, so if you and I sign a contract which says that neither of us can talk about what's in it, you know, my first thought is, why shouldn't we do that if that's what we want to do? But sometimes there is a sort of public policy aspect to this. And, you know, I think sometimes for the rest of society, it would be good if we knew what happened. You know, if some employer abuses an employee, sexually harasses her or something like that, I'm not sure that that's the sort of thing that should be kept quiet. So I could imagine moving to a situation where, you know, the laws say, no, we won't enforce that agreement to stay quiet. Huh. We haven't got there yet.
No, I can see. And I think it's interesting how it plays out. I'm inclined to agree with you. I think that people, if they are going into a deal with, you know, open eyes, that they should be allowed to make the terms that they want, assuming that one side isn't taking advantage of the other side, who may simply be incapable of handling a contract. But, you know, two grown-ups get together and make a deal. It seems fair that they should be able to choose whether it's private or public.
So you don't think that if A sexually harasses B, I mean, you think it's okay if they then agree A pays something to B for that, the harm done, and then they agree not to talk about it?
Well, presuming that there's no criminal, if there's no criminal case here, in which case then the police should be involved. I don't understand why. In which case, of course, the police should be involved. But if they come to an agreement, they come to an agreement. He might simply pay what it's worth to her.
Yeah, I'm just not sure about that. I think there's some spillover to the rest of society from all the secretiveness. So it may not be. But you're taking a more kind of respecting the contract position than I am. I'm not sure about this, but I can see in the future we might be moving in the direction of making things more public.
I see. Well, I'm from the people of the book, and we are very serious about what the original contract says. So.
Yeah.
And that's all we have today. You know, although interestingly, and it's a topic for another day, then we really have to wrap up. You know, in the Jewish tradition, we have the Bible, which is the written law, and then we have the Talmud, which is the oral law, which is the case law that was discussed and actually came into effect over hundreds, literally thousands of years today that people still study. So it seems that there's room, like you're saying, for two sides. There's the actual written contract, the law, and then there's the development of the interpretation over the years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's getting a little far. I'd have to think about that.
All right, well, we'll bring you back on that next time. Yeah. All right, Professor, listen, we are just about out of time now. In fact, we are well over time, but I certainly enjoyed talking with you. Tell me in the last few seconds, how can people learn more about the work you're doing?
Well, they could visit my Harvard website, which you can easily access. You just Google Oliver Hart and you will be directed there. Whether you'll find anything that will be helpful for you, you know, I don't know. But you could try. I welcome visitors.
Okay. And I understand there's no promises and there's no contractual obligation that you are signing yourself to if people come to your site and, in fact, are not that interested. But we will put a link to it at the website of today's show at goldsteinongelt.com.
They don't have to pay anything. Look at it that way. There's no charge.
Oh, man, that is a whole new discussion. Even if you don't pay, like with Facebook and Google, but you have to give them your information, is that paying in another way?
No information either. Nothing. Yeah. It's a free thing. It's a freebie.
All right. Thanks so much for taking the time.
Thank you.
You've been listening to the Goldstein on Gelt show with money maven Doug Goldstein. Check out all of Doug's money ideas at goldsteinongelt.com. Doug specializes in helping people who live outside the United States handle their U.S. investment accounts. If you have a question that you would like answered on the air or off, contact Doug at his website or send him an email to doug@profile-financial.com.